talking about his films and their impact on popular culture. Between 1992 and 2019, Tarantino wrote and directed 9 films. These are genre films crossing multiple genres, but they have such a singular feel to them, something that is so Tarantino that in 2018, the Oxford English Dictionary added a new word. That word is Tarantino-esque, right? These are now films or other forms of art that resemble or imitate the films of Quentin Tarantino. What are characteristics of those films? Well, you can see it starts with graphic and stylized violence. Not a surprise that that's the first element of that definition. Non-linear storylines. Pulp Fiction is the epitome of a non-linear storyline, where the film basically starts and ends at the same point in time. Cine-literate references. I'll make a point about that in just a moment when I show you this quote from Michael Madsen. Satirical themes, particularly in films such as Inglourious Basterds and Django Unchained, and sharp dialogue. Nobody writes dialogue better than Quentin Tarantino. He was right off the bat in 1992, Reservoir Dogs. You have a group of men sitting in a diner eating breakfast, preparing to go rob a jewelry store. And yet they spend 10 to 15 minutes together talking about the meaning of Madonna's song, Like a Virgin. What is that song supposed to mean? In Pulp Fiction, his second film, you have Vincent Vega and Jules Winfield driving to a hit, talking about what a quarter pounder with cheese is called in Paris, because they've got the metric system. They wouldn't know what a quarter pounder is. It's a Royale with cheese. So this dialogue has become part of the culture, part of the way, especially in the United States, a lot of people talk, incorporate that as well. Back to this idea of cine-literate references. Here's Michael Madsen, who starred in 4 of Tarantino's films. He said, if you think that you know more about a movie or an actor or anything to do with cinema history, he will bury you with how much he knows. And how much he knows is always integrated into his stories. And every time I watch one of his films, I feel like I'm seeing something or hearing something that makes me learn more about cinema history as well. It would be completely accurate to say that the course that I'm teaching this semester on Italian Westerns was directly influenced by, inspired by Tarantino's own love of that genre and how he has incorporated spaghetti Westerns into his own work. So speaking of those storylines in his films, here are the 9 films that Tarantino has written and directed. Reservoir Dogs was his directorial debut in 1992. Pulp Fiction in 1994. By the way, Pulp Fiction is ranked by the American Film Institute as one of the 100 greatest American films of all time. So it is in very select company. In 1997, Tarantino wrote and directed Jackie Brown. Jackie Brown is actually the one screenplay of his that is not an original screenplay. He wrote the screenplay, but adapted it from an Elmore Leonard novel called Rum Punch that was released in 1992. He's the lover of Elmore Leonard's novels and took Rum Punch and adapted it into Jackie Brown. In 2003, he released Kill Bill Volume 1, followed by Kill Bill Volume 2 in 2004. Despite the fact that these two were released a year apart, Tarantino considers these to be one film, one of his 9 films. In 2007, he released Death Proof as part of a double feature, what he called a grindhouse feature with Robert Rodriguez, who directed Planet Terror. This is a vastly underrated film of Tarantino's, and I'll be discussing it in a little bit. In 2009, we have the World War II epic Inglourious Basterds. In 2012, Django Unchained, which is very much a postmodern spaghetti Western. In 2015, The Hateful Eight. And then his 9th film, released in 2019, was Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. In addition to cine-literate references, in addition to the sharp dialogue, these films are known for their music, for their language, unsavory language at times, and certainly for their violence. If you've seen Reservoir Dogs, you can never hear the song Stuck in the Middle with You by Steeler's Wheel the same way again, because it plays over a torture scene where Mr. Blonde takes a razor blade and cuts off the ear of Officer Marvin Nash to a very upbeat pop song. Also, to the opening credits of Pulp Fiction, we hear this music. A fantastic song that dates back to 1962. This is called Miserloo by Dick Dale and his Deltones. And yet, I don't think I would have known that song had it not been for its inclusion in Pulp Fiction in this way. Speaking of language, someone took the time to count the number of F words in his first eight films, ranging from a low of 18 in The Hateful Eight to a massive total of 269 in Reservoir Dogs. This was his first screenplay, Pulp Fiction his second, Jackie Brown his third. Well, he really went for it in those early screenplays with the F word. Now, a lot of deaths as well. As a matter of fact, there's a great line in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood where DiCaprio's character, Rick Dalton, is having a dinner meeting with Al Pacino's Marvin Schwartz. He says, I love all that killing. And Rick Dalton goes, a lot of killing. And there's a lot of killing here, from a minimum of four deaths in Jackie Brown to 369 in Inglourious Basterds. By my best count, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood has three deaths, but those deaths are so dramatic, so intense, so concentrated in time and space that it feels like a lot more than three in that regard. As we move into getting ready to talk about some specific theoretical concepts and principles dealing with this micro-sociological theory of violence, I wanted to provide very quickly a set of broader sociological or criminological themes that also run through his nine films, and I think will help us make sense of this micro theory in just a moment. Okay, so these four themes are rationality, reliability, retribution, and redemption. So with regard to rationality, let me say that I'm a criminologist. That's typically how I define myself in my work, or a sociologist. The discipline of criminology was born here in Italy. Cesare Beccaria, who was born a son of an aristocratic family in Milan in 1764 during the Enlightenment, wrote a book called On Crimes and Punishment. And along with Beccaria, an English philosopher named Jeremy Bentham, from their works, we have in criminology the ideas about human beings possessing free will. And we exercise that free will in a rational way. What does it mean to be rational? It means to choose actions that maximize our pleasure and minimize our pain. That's what it means to be rational, and the entire discipline of criminology started with that emphasis on rationality. Well, this idea of maximizing pleasure, minimizing pain is a recurring theme among almost all characters in the film, including Samuel L. Jackson's character here from Jackie Brown. This is Ordell Roby. Ordell is explicit at a point. He has just shot and killed his associate named Beaumont Livingston. Beaumont's in his trunk. And Ordell tells another business partner and friend, Louis Guerra, why he did it. He said, over a series of events, it was going to be either him or me. And you best believe it wasn't going to be me. So it was a very rational choice, right? Maximizing pleasure, minimizing pain. Reliability. This is the idea about living according to a code, the code of your group, the code of your subculture, demonstrating loyalty to that. One of the most important books in my life as a sociologist is a 1930 book called The Jack Roller, a delinquent boy's own story written by Clifford Shaw, who was from the University of Chicago in the early 20th century. And it tells the story of a boy named Stanley who, for most of his childhood and most of his adolescence, spent time in jails and juvenile reformatories. And in Stanley's autobiography, he says, my belief in the code was unbreakable. The code is considered by all criminals a standard to live up to, and it is an unpardonable sin to violate this code by squawking. and he would rather die than squawk on a fellow prisoner. So this was his code. There is this idea about loyalty to a code. Typically, it's a criminal code in the films of Tarantino, but nonetheless, it's the idea of, are you going to prove to be reliable to others? Are you going to be loyal? Here in this scene, this is from Reservoir Dogs. All of these thieves have subscribed to a code about not sharing any information about themselves with the others, not their names, not where they've come from, not other jobs that they've pulled. As a matter of fact, the leader of the group, Joe Cabot, gives them all color-coded names so they don't even refer to themselves as Charlotte or Christopher or Tanner. It's Mr. Pink, Mr. Blonde, Mr. Blue, Mr. Brown, Mr. Orange, etc. And their success is going to be dependent on their ability to be reliable, to demonstrate loyalty to that code. Retribution. Okay, if there's anything that defines a Tarantino film, it's this idea. What happens when you violate that code? Punishment rains down on you in the form of some retributive justice. But the point that I wanted to make is this idea of retribution is not limited to the world of cinema or the films of Tarantino. It is built, at least in the United States and certainly in Oklahoma, retribution is built into our laws and policies as well. I've given you a section of Title 22 of the Oklahoma statutes. This title deals with fugitives from justice. And you can see here it says the purpose of this act is to allow the activities of an individual to be dealt with in one court at a time, no matter where the activities occurred, to the end that society may be afforded retribution. Retribution for offenses against it. And then we think about the rehabilitative process after retribution. In another section of the same title, the Oklahoma statutes, the legislature lays out the purposes and policies of the criminal justice and corrections systems in Oklahoma. And in order, the first three of those purposes are, number one, protection of the public. Number two, punishment of the offender. And only after we've punished the offender do we think about number three, rehabilitation of the offender. So retribution is built into the way we think about punishment for crimes done against us. This is Bill, the snake charmer, the bill of Kill Bill. And at the beginning of Kill Bill Volume 1, Bill shoots Uma Thurman's character, the bride, in the head after he has already murdered her entire wedding party. This is an act of retribution on his part because he believes she has violated the code, his code, the code of the Deadly Viper Assassination Squad. And then redemption, almost kind of a paradox with that of retribution. But there is, particularly in Tarantino's later films, a theme of redemption that runs through many of his stories. You can see in this excerpt from McAdams and colleagues' article about redemptive sequences, they say that the bad is redeemed, salvaged, mitigated, or made better in light of the ensuing good. And through several of his films, including Inglourious Bastards, where Hitler is murdered, including Django Unchained, where Django is able to overthrow the plantation system of the antebellum South, including Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, where actress Sharon Tate survives rather than being murdered by the Manson family in August of 1969. But throughout many films, there is this idea of redeeming, salvaging, mitigating, making something better. Sometimes it is of that historical nature, redeeming us from these evils of history. Sometimes it's redemption of a person or of a relationship. And this is Hans Landa from Inglourious Bastards. And again, there's a certainly a very important redemptive theme to that film. And then just very quickly, finally here, with the idea of representation, I would say if there's one of Tarantino's nine films that is the best representation of all of those themes, demonstrating rationality, reliability, retribution, and redemption, it is Pulp Fiction from 1994. This is Jules Winfield and the text of Ezekiel 25:17, not the exact text that you'll find in the Bible, but cinematic version of it that we will listen to here in a few minutes. There is particularly with Jules. He goes through a redemption of his own in the film. So a great representation of all of those things, of those themes. All right. Now, Tarantino's films have also become a source of controversy for their portrayals of violence. Over many years, Tarantino has fielded questions from interviewers trying to understand place and purpose of graphic and stylized violence in his films. As a writer and director, Tarantino recognizes that his films are not real life and that violence has cinematic value. Tarantino has said, quote, "Violence is one of the greatest things you can do in cinema," end quote. Why? Because it creates dramatic tension. It can also create comedic relief, depending on how it is used, how it is phrased, the context of it. Now, an argument that I'm making here tonight is that there is also sociological value to the violence in his films. If we look beyond or beneath the graphic and stylized portrayal of violence, we find micro-sociological representations of violent confrontations that I think can actually help us understand real-world violence. So, to this idea of micro-sociology, in 2008, sociologist Randall Collins published a micro-sociological theory of violence in this book called Violence. And rather than focusing on violent individuals, it's a theory of violent situations. He says it's a false search to look for violent individuals because even the most violent among us are violent a minuscule amount of time. The amount of time that the most heinous serial killers in the United States actually were ever involved in violence would maybe constitute minutes out of their lives. So he says we need to focus on violent situations. And the theory argues that confrontational tension and fear structure these situations, and so that differences in violent interactions are associated with overcoming this kind of tension and fear. Now, before we get into a few of these films, let me make a few more comments. Most confrontations, and my hallucination is this, that most of us in the room have been in some form of confrontation with another person, but that confrontation did not lead to violence. Well, that would be predicted by the theory. Most confrontations do not become violent because the tension of the interaction itself is too strong. It repels us away from that space with another person. In short, violence is hard to do. It is hard to do. We're not wired for it, whether we think about it from a socialization perspective or an evolutionary psychological perspective. We are meant for solidarity. We're meant for attachment, for bonding, not for conflict. So for violence to occur, individuals must find a pathway around this barrier of confrontational tension and fear. There are multiple pathways that include something called a forward panic, which I'll demonstrate in Pulp Fiction in a moment, attacking a weak victim, containing or regulating violence through situations like staged fair fights, and then even treating violence as a form of entertainment or even a moral holiday. And so let's take a look at some of those pathways around tension and fear in a few of Tarantino's films. I'm going to focus specifically on Reservoir Dogs, Pulp Fiction, Kill Bill Volume 1, Death Proof, and Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, right? All right, and I think we're doing well on time to finish up by 7 o'clock for that. What's that? Yeah.
Kill Bill Volume 1 is certainly my favorite because there's scene of violence, action, like fighting.
Absolutely. Yes. It's one of my favorite too. I just had a conversation this morning at breakfast about this, I think, and that always stands as one of my favorites as well. That's great. That's great. Well, I will show a scene here in just a moment from that. So here's a great little Lego recreation of the famous torture scene from Reservoir Dogs. And in Reservoir Dogs, we get insight into these processes of confrontational tension and incompetent violence. So let me tell you what what Randall Collins means by that. Let's start with this concept of fearful and incompetent. Okay. According to Randall Collins, quote, fighters are mostly fearful and incompetent in their exercise of violence. When they are evenly matched, they tend to be particularly incompetent. It is when the strong attack the weak that most violence is successful. And so in Reservoir Dogs, we see that most of these guys are in fact fearful and incompetent. The jewelry store heist is botched. Most of them die on the way back to the warehouse, their meeting place. Almost everyone but one person dies by the end of the film in that regard. Here's Steve Buscemi as Mr. Pink. You can just see in his facial expressions, there is this sense of tension and fear. Certainly he's angry. He's in a confrontation with Mr. White at this point. They have their guns pointed at each other. But look at his face. Look at the micro expressions. And what do you see? You see fear and incompetence here in this character. The most violent situation in the film happens indeed when the strong attack the weak. When Mr. Blonde, razor blade in hand, attacks Officer Nash tied up to a chair. The strong attacking the weak in that regard. All right. Also, according to Collins, quote, fighters get into a state of fear or at least high tension as soon as the confrontation comes to the point of violence. It is a collective, interactional mood that characterizes the violent encounter on all sides and that shapes the behavior of all its participants in several typical ways. So in this warehouse where most of the film is set, almost every scene is characterized by this tension and fear, this collective interactional mood. This is the late Chris Penn, who starred as nice guy Eddie, whose stance, his posture, his point, his facial expressions all suggest that he is subjected to that same tension and fear that Mr. Pink is feeling. It characterizes the interaction, the social situation. It's not simply a feature, a psychological or an emotional feature of an individual, but it characterizes the interactions themselves. And then, again, another quote from Randall Collins, quote, much of the time the tension is too strong. Individuals cannot approach the confrontational zone closely, being content to fling words or sometimes missiles from a distance. Or they approach it only briefly and then are driven away from it by their own bodies, emotions, and nervous systems, end quote. So remember, violence is difficult. The closer individuals get to this confrontational zone, the harder it is to stay there. We're wired for solidarity, not conflict. And we see here a final confrontation in Reservoir Dogs. And I'm going to show you this scene. And in this scene, you're going to see a variety of things. Number one, you're going to see that this incompetent level of violence. We've got here on your far left, you've got nice guy Eddie. You've got Joe Cabot in the background. And then to your right, you've got to Mr. White. All guns pointed at each other, all evenly matched, all end up dead. Sorry for the spoiler, all right? But Eddie and Joe die immediately. Mr. White, or Larry, as he's also known, is mortally wounded here. And then you have perhaps the most rational character of all, Mr. Pink, played by Steve Buscemi. What does he do? He hides. He finds a crawl space under a loading ramp, and he hides. And because he was fearful, he's the only one that survives this. So let me play this scene for you.
I don't need proof when you have instinct. I ignored it before, but no more. You lost your fucking mind.
Joe, you're making a terrible mistake. I'm not gonna let you make.
Come on, guys. Nobody wants this. We're supposed to be fucking professionals.
All right, look. It's been quite a long time. A lot of jobs. There's no need for this, man. Let's just put our guns down. And let's settle this with a fucking conversation.
Joe, if you kill that man, you die next. Repeat, if you kill that man, you die next.
Larry, we have been friends. And you respect my dad and I respect you, but I will put fucking bullets right through your heart. You put that fucking gun down now.
God damn you, Joe. Don't make me do
the,
this.
The Larry,
stop pointing
that
fucking gun at my dad!
Exactly. Eddie dead, Joe dead, Larry or Mr. White mortally wounded, and look who peeks out. And Mr. Pink is able to make off with the diamonds. The only character in the movie, I think, that actually survives from beginning to end right there. And so, again, a demonstration of confrontational tension and incompetent violence. So now let's take a look at Pulp Fiction. I found this other great little Lego recreation inside Brett's apartment. Brett, hands up, and Jules Winfield getting ready to engage in a forward panic. What is a forward panic? Let's talk about this concept here. According to Randall Collins, quote, a forward panic starts with tension and fear in a conflict situation. This is the normal condition of violent conflict, but here, the tension is prolonged and built up. It has a dramatic shape of increasing tension, striving toward a climax. And the scene that I will show you in just a moment has that prolonged built-up tension to a climax that leads to violence that is unstoppable. Quote, a forward panic is violence that for the time being is unstoppable. It is overkill. The use of force far beyond what would have been needed to bring about the victory, end quote. And there are multiple examples of this unstoppable overkill of forward panic in Pulp Fiction. One scene is Bruce Willis as Butch Coolidge, a boxer. He has a confrontation, a violent confrontation with Marcellus Wallace in this pawn shop. And Butch has got the better of him. He has him on the floor and he is punching him as a boxer would know how to punch. And if it wasn't for the owner of the pawn shop intervening for very nefarious reasons, if it wasn't for him intervening, Butch would have undoubtedly punched Marcellus until Marcellus was dead. It was a form of overkill. He had subdued Marcellus Wallace, but was going and going and going. And then the third concept, and then we'll take a look at the scene that I want to show you. Quote, a forward panic arises in an atmosphere of total domination. The domination is emotional even more than physical. The victorious side feels ebullient, charged up. The losing side feels despairing, helpless, frozen, suffocated, end quote. This is Marcellus Wallace, and toward the end of the film in that same pawn shop, in the basement of that pawn shop, a character named Zed is raping Marcellus Wallace. It is a physical and emotional domination at this point. However, Butch intervenes in the rape. Marcellus now has a shotgun. He blows a hole in Zed's gut and then says, now I'm in a position of total domination. And I am going to engage in a forward panic, prolonged and built up, unstoppable, total domination. So let's watch this scene in Brett's apartment where the wonderful Samuel L. Jackson as Jules Winfield is talking with Brett. Brett proved unreliable. He was in a business dealing with Marcellus Wallace. He was not loyal. Now Marcellus's two hitmen, Jules and Vincent, have decided to pay a visit to Brett.
Anybody except Mrs. Wallace. You read the Bible, Brett?
Yes.
Well, there's this passage I got memorized. Sort of fits this occasion. Ezekiel 25:17. The path of the righteous man is beset on all sides by the inequities of the selfish and the tyranny of evil men. Blessed is he who in the name of charity and goodwill shepherds the weak through the valley of darkness, for he is truly his brother's keeper and the finder of lost children. And I will strike down upon thee with great vengeance and furious anger those who attempt to poison and destroy my brothers. And you will know my name is the Lord when I lay my vengeance upon thee.
Two hitmen, two guns, empty their clips into one person there. All right. There's a bit of an example of a forward panic where that tension is prolonged and built up. The violence becomes unstoppable. It's overkill and a form of total domination over Brett there. And it's as much an emotional domination as it is physical in that regard. All right. Now to Kill Bill Volume 1. And we're going to talk here in Kill Bill Volume 1, released in 2003, about this idea of staging fair fights. Another way around that barrier of confrontational tension and fear. Collins says this in his book, quote, "The original referent of hero is just such an individual who takes part in violent contests while submitting herself or himself to social rules, rules that are explicitly agreed on beforehand." And it is precisely these rules that fighters agree on that allow them to diffuse the tension and fear of a violent confrontation, because now their attention is focused on the rules rather than the tension and fear of the confrontation itself. In literature, this idea of heroes and single combats is probably most evident in Homer's The Iliad, where you have, for example, Achilles and Hector fighting. This is in the context of the Trojan War, but you have these two heroes coming together for a single combat between them. In Kill Bill Volume 1, we have Uma Thurman as the bride in multiple single combats. I'm going to show you a scene here in just a moment where she agrees upon the rules of a staged fair fight with another member of the Deadly Viper assassination squad. Her name is Vernita Green. So we'll look at that here in just a moment. The audience, I love talking about this one because it brings us also into the discussion. Collins says this, quote, "The audience is crucial in a staged fight. It provides the support that circumvents confrontational tension and fear, and it helps enact the limits that give the fight its etiquette and make it a fair fight," end quote. And he asks the question in his book, well, what makes an audience favorable to a fight? Why would we go to it? One of his answers is that when fights are announced beforehand, prior announcement of a fight tends to make an audience more favorable for it. My daughter, who is currently in college at the University of Kentucky, I remember clear as day when she was in middle school, she came home, not middle school, elementary school. She came home on a Monday or Tuesday and said, "Dad, there's going to be a fight on the playground on Friday." There was this prior announcement, a confrontation between two boys, and they set out, okay, we're going to fight it out. We're going to duke it out on the playground Friday. And she was bubbling with excitement. She was very favorable. And she talked about and anticipated this fight all week long. Sadly for her, the confrontation fizzled, right? Remember, violence is hard, whether we're children or adults. And so the two boys never fought. But that prior announcement made her, and I imagine others, students her age, a little bit excited about going to this. Now, with this, think about it. We also perform in this role of the audience. We go to the cinema, we go to the theater to watch this. And was there a prior announcement of this fight? The prior announcement is in the title of the film itself. What are we going to watch? We're going to watch Kill Bill, right? We know already that this is going to involve some type of violence. Now, Collins also looks at the distinction between fair fights or vendettas. And we ask the question, is Uma Thurman's The Bride involved in fair fights or in vendettas? Collins says that vendettas are not fair fights. They are drawn out in time and notoriously self-perpetuating. And I think that there's elements of both as I watch this. The Bride has a vendetta against the entire Deadly Viper assassination squad. And she will not stop until she murders or maims every last one of them. But when it comes to the single combats, she subjects herself to the rules of these staged fair fights. So let's watch The Bride and Vernita Green agree on the rules. When are we going to fight? Where are we going to fight? What are we going to wear? What weapon are we going to use? Those are all explicitly discussed. We'll come up here.
Look, I know I fucked you over. I fucked you over bad. I wish to God I hadn't, but I did. You have every right to want to get even.
No. To get even? Even, Stephen? I would have to kill you. Go up to Nikki's room, kill her. Then wait for your husband, the good Dr. Bell, to come home and kill him. That would be even, Vernita. That'd be about square.
Look, if I could go back in a machine, I would. But I can't. All I can tell you is that I'm a different person now.
Oh, great. I don't care.
Be that as it may, I know I don't deserve your mercy or your forgiveness. However, I beseech you for both on behalf of my daughter.
Bitch, you can stop right there. Just because I have no wish to murder you before the eyes of your daughter does not mean that parading her around in front of me is going to inspire sympathy. You and I have unfinished business, and not a goddamn fucking thing you've done in the subsequent 4 years, including getting knocked up, is going to change that.
So when do we do this?
Here we go.
It all depends. When do you want to die? Tomorrow? The day after tomorrow?
How about tonight, bitch?
Splendid. Where?
There's a baseball diamond where I coach our little league about a mile from here. We meet there around 2:30 in the morning, dressed all in black. Your hair in a black stocking. And we have us a knife fight. We won't be bothered.
And there we go. So agreed upon rules for a staged fair fight. Now, these two would be also considered what Collins would call the violent few, meaning that they are skilled in the social processes of overcoming tension and fear anyway. But nevertheless, they're still agreeing upon the rules of when this is going to happen. All right, now, given time, I want to respect your time and try to get us finished at 7 o'clock here. I think I'm going to go to Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, because this is an interesting one that discusses the concept of how fights start or not. And so let's take a look. All right, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, and we learn something in this film and incorporate this part of Collins' theory about how fights start, or sometimes how that fights don't start, how we can use things like boast and bluster to actually kind of move into that confrontational zone, but not have to get to the point of actual violence. So let's start with this concept of verbal acrimony. Remember, and I'll quote from Collins here, violence is socially difficult, and it is much more common to carry out social rituals that pretend to fight, but confine it to conventionalized gesturing. The gesturing takes two forms. One is verbal acrimony, which is carried out through griping, whining, arguing, and quarreling, each more intense than the one before, end quote. Well, if you've seen Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, and I know my global social problems class has, Leonardo DiCaprio plays Rick Dalton. Rick Dalton was a television and film actor. He started in a Western TV series called Bounty Law, left that series to try his hand at motion pictures. Rick Dalton's story is a story of verbal acrimony from start to finish. He gripes about hippies overtaking Hollywood in 1969. He whines about the state of his acting career. He argues with a director about costume choices, and he argues with himself about his drinking and forgetting his lines. And he appears ready to quarrel with just about anyone other than his stuntman and good friend, Cliff Booth, portrayed by Brad Pitt. And so we see somebody who appears ready to fight in this film all the time, but he confines all of that to that, those forms of verbal acrimony. All right, boasting and blustering from Collins, quote, the other type of gesturing is boast and bluster. Boasting comes in two forms, as a general assertion of one's status in the world and boasting in the face of an immediate rival. Bluster is the final step before violence. It is an expression of pointed threat, anger directed at an immediate opponent. And in this particular scene, this is a flashback that Brad Pitt's character, Cliff Booth, has to when he was on the set of The Green Hornet. He was Rick Dalton's stunt double. Rick had a guest spot on The Green Hornet. And we see this scene where there's all kinds of boast and bluster between Brad Pitt's character, Cliff Booth, and Bruce Lee, who played the character of Kato on The Green Hornet. And while the boast and bluster between these two characters ends up essentially in a staged fair fight, and they go through explicit rules as well, no touching of the head, you know, or the hands or face, because they have to be on camera shortly. There are other times where that boast and bluster can actually lead into violence as well. It is the final step before violence. And then, and I'm going to show you this scene of violence here just a moment. Quote, quarreling and blustering follow four micro pathways flowing into or away from the tunnel of violence. And bluster is likely to lead onward to a fight if one side feels much stronger than the other, or if there is a highly interested audience. In this scene, Cliff Booth is at Spawn Ranch, south of Los Angeles. Spawn Ranch had been a movie ranch where he had worked at in the late 50s, and it is now home to members of the Charles Manson family. And Cliff finds himself at Spawn Ranch, and as he's walking back to his boss's car, to Rick's car, he finds that Clem has stuck a knife into the tire. And there's a bit of boast, there's a bit of bluster, and Cliff believes in this situation that he is much stronger than his weaker opponent. There is a highly interested audience of young girls in the Manson family. And let's see how this progresses in the film. And this will be my final video for you. And then thank you. Thank you for being here. You already see the evidence of the audience, highly interested audience.
Yeah, I got to get away. do that? You know, that's not my car. That's my boss's car. And if something were to happen to my boss's car, well, I'd get in trouble. Lucky for you, he's got a spare. Fix it.
Ha 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 ha! Fuck you!
Now watch the next one. He's performing for this audience. The audience is keeping the violence going.
Ladies. Come one step closer and I will knock his teeth out.
All right. Needless to say, Clem fixes the tire. He's a weaker opponent here, and the strong have attacked the weak. And so this is information that I have for all nine of his films. It's something that I'm continuing to work on from a research perspective. I love these films as enjoyment start, first and foremost. But the more I watch them, the more I realize that there is layers and layers of social meaning and meaning about the nature and purpose and role of violence as well. So I thank you for joining me and participating. I did not leave really room for questions, though I'm still happy to take some or to hang out and talk for as long as anyone wants to for it. So thank you all, and thank you everyone online for being with me today.
Christopher, can you hear me?
Yes, Dr. Burns.
Yeah, first of all, excellent job. Really interesting stuff, Christopher. I have to, you really had my attention all the way through. I do have a question. You know, Aristotle, back in the Poetics, 2,500 years ago, talked about the role of catharsis. And I wonder, the Greek tragedies and so forth at the time that he was unpacking had a cathartic element where people could work through emotions through the violence typically and other things, but typically the violence in those old plays like Oedipus and so forth. What would you say is the role of catharsis here for the audience?
Oh, for the audience watching. Yes. Well, I will say this, Dr. Burns, that this is Randall Collins, and I'm sure that you know Randall Collins as a theorist much sure. better than I do. but this theory is one that is about emotions. That's one of the things I love about micro-sociology is it incorporates an emotional component. And that idea of catharsis is that we are feeling something emotionally by it. And earlier in a class that I taught earlier today, one of the students, we were talking about the murder of, at the end of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, instead of Tex and Sadie and Katie murdering Sharon Tate and her house guests, those members of the Manson family in this redemptive story, they get murdered instead. And I think that we do feel that sense of emotional catharsis, this release of emotion and relief from the tension of knowing what exactly happened. I don't know. I don't recall that Collins discusses the notion or the concept of catharsis specifically, but knowing how much that this theory surrounds emotions, I think it's a very appropriate to consider, and certainly to consider for us as the audience to these films.
Yeah. Thank you.
You bet. I've known Dr. Burns, by the way, for 20 years. And he is one of our fantastic professors in sociology and a great mentor and friend. Yes. Crystal.
What's your favorite one and why?
So it changes a little bit from year to year, or when I'm watching or what mood I'm in. But I would say consistently, Kill Bill Volume 1 and Once Upon a Time in Hollywood are my two favorites. Yeah, but the why to it is I love the stories behind them and the characters, and whether I identify with the characters or not, I see how well developed they are. And there are stories that I could just talk about all night long, right? With you, with my wife Mindy, with my children, and but yeah, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood and Kill Bill Volume 1. Yeah.
For what regards the main theme of Tarantino's movie, it's more violence or sometimes even a little bit of action. I mean,
sure, a little bit of action and a lot of comedy as well.
Your hostel, my friend watched the hostel.
Oh, yes,
hostel. It's a dramatic one.
Yes, the director's name, and it's unfortunately escaping me, but the director of Hostel. Eli Roth, yes, thank you, played Sergeant Donnie Donowitz, whose nickname was the Bear Jew, in Inglourious Basterds, yes. And so they've had a long working relationship. So yeah, thank you for reminding me of Roth's name. Yeah. But that is one thing that Tarantino is explicit about, is he wants us to feel different emotions in his film. So sometimes violence, sometimes action, sometimes comedy, sometimes a little bit of horror. There is the scene where Brad Pitt's character, Cliff Booth, goes into George Spawn's home, and you get the feeling that you just entered a horror movie. You're not sure. I wasn't sure the first time I saw it if Cliff would make it out alive. And so he wants us to, you know, laugh, 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 and then stop and be horrified or terrified, and then laugh again. And those contradictory emotions, I think, are also part of the draw of the films. Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you, everybody, for coming.
Thank you. Yes, thank you, Charlotte.
Feel free again to stick around and ask questions or have something else to drink.
Okay. Yes. Thank you all. Appreciate you
very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chris, for so much information.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, go ahead. What was that? What was that, Dad?
So much information to cover. We wish you'd had more time.
Too much for an hour.
That's true.
Yeah.
Nicely done, Chris. Take care.
Thank you. Thank you, Tom. I appreciate you.
Enjoyed it.
Take care.
Uh-huh. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Okay, let me do this. Yeah.